Dzień dobry Państwu, witam bardzo serdecznie na kolejnym z cyklu wykładów, które Instytut Studiów Zaawansowanych organizuje dzięki wsparciu Fundacji im. Róży Luksemburg, z cyklu wykładów Nowa Ekonomia Czasów Kryzysu. Dziś naszym gościem będzie pan profesor Kazimierz Łaski, którego przedstawi nam moderujący, jak zwykle, dyskusję profesor Jerzy Osiateński. Od razu zapraszam Państwa na następny wykład. To będzie 18 grudnia. Naszym gościem będzie pan profesor Leon Podkaminer, a tymczasem oddaję głos panu profesorowi Osiateńskiemu. I jeszcze poproszę, zgodnie z naszą świecką tradycją, o wpisanie się do celów inwigilacyjnych na naszą listę.
Good evening, everybody. It's good to see you again. 2 weeks ago, we had Professor Thomas Palle here. Tonight, our guest is Professor Łaski. He is the best and most committed from all the economists I know, follower and formerly a student of Michał Kalecki. And within the flow of generations, in the succession of generations, as some of you may know already, I've been a student of Łaski. So in a sense, there is some succession also of ideas. Also, Professor Łaski, when the deputy chancellor of the Warsaw School of Economics, which at the time was called the Central School of Planning and Statistics, was the person who invited Kalecki to give lectures, regular lectures, in Warsaw. And as a matter of fact, from what I know of biography of Kalecki, and I think I know a lot, these were the first regular, systematic academic lectures that Kalecki taught. The subject of today's lecture of Professor Łaski relates to a paper that Kalecki wrote in 1939. The title of the paper was Money and Real Wages. It was a political study in which Kalecki showed that, contrary to the then, and we talk about 38, 39, last century, then dominating view that reduction of money wages can help to overcome a business cycle, has demonstrated theoretically and then as a case study based on statistics that were prepared in the Institute of Economic Research where Kalecki worked, that also in Poland, the statistics demonstrated this was no way to help over the course of a business cycle to increase profits, thereby investments, thereby improve the business cycle. When you look at the problems and discussions nowadays in Poland, the question revolves, came back, and often what is the main subject of many propositions that relate to deregulation of the labor market. The true essence is to reduce wages in relation to profits as a remedy to increase employment. So the question that Professor Laski asks, does declining wage share stimulate economic growth, has not only historical but most practical importance. And what he will show to us is a theoretical construct on the basis of which you all on your own shall be able to demonstrate and to understand what is the what are the relationships, and is the answer in the positive or in the negative. Now, since there are some people who were in the hall, in the audience, 2 days ago at the Polish Economists Association, where we had a conference on Kalecki, where I was asked the question about what is the economy that Kalecki discusses, and I said there wrongly that the main reference point or model for Kalecki is a free competitive economy. I want to correct it. And that was immediately shown by Kazik to me, that that was a mistake. And as a matter of fact, in this 39 essay, and also in some other essays, he does discuss the three economy model. But as a matter of fact, his reference point is a monopoly economy, a duopoly or a monopoly economy where prices are not determined by supply and demand, but by markups determined by producers, according to his theory of price determination and wage distribution. Since there are some people in the hall here who attended this conference 2 days ago, I just wanted to make this correction so that the mistake is admitted and that you will be able to see what is the essence of it. Now, I think it's high time for me to give the floor to Professor Laski. The floor is yours.
May I see? Yes?
Yes.
First of all, I would like to ask a question, whether there is somebody, how serious is the problem of speaking English in this at this lecture? It is obligatory, or it?
As far as I can see, there are.
Is anybody speaking? Anybody here in the audience who does not speak Polish? Okay, this is enough. So let us continue. I'm sorry, my English is very bad, by far not as good as of Professor Jatinski, but it is understandable. Okay, so. Okay. I move it by here. And I start by the introduction, consumer goods service, two sector productivity oriented. For the introduction.
Może ja się będę o to opowiadał. Okay, I'll help you.
Okay. Yes, because I have. Well, I can go to you.
Okay.
See, there are, I think, three major changes in the modern, in the present situation, which I mean modern in the sense of last quarter century or more, period after 1980. First, this is the change in income distribution. And I intend to discuss this topic. The second one, which we're not going to discuss, is globalization. I think these two topics are indeed the very necessary changes in relation to the period before 1980. And we should take account of these two if you want to understand what happens said. What can be done. When I speak about the change in distribution, I will deal only with functional distribution, which means distribution with wages and profits. There's another aspect of distribution, namely personal distribution, distribution according to families and so on, which underwent changes not less, perhaps even much more than those in the functional distribution. But this is not the topic of my present lecture. I move to the main topic, consumer goods service. You see, I decided to go to the very basic of the problem, risking that I repeat topics which are very known to you or not. But you see, when you understand really what happens at the very basic, or a theory, then we can understand what follows. And as this problem of labor market flexibility, which practically means, as we know, a drive to lower wages, as a means of solving all problems, first of all, the problem of unemployment, it is very, very important to understand why this does not work and produces results which are contrary to expect. So this is why I go to this very basic. And to be sure that we understand each other, I start with a very, very primitive example. Namely, I assume that the whole economy consists of one bakery. This is a bakery which is vertically integrated, which means this bakery produces its own seeds and so on. It's
corn.
It owns corn and everything. Which means that the final product of this bakery is bread, and it consists only of value added. There is no input because everything is inside work. And now we assume that labor productivity per worker is 12 loaves of bread, and the wage rate is 8 loaves, and the profit is 4 loaves. Of course, this is it should not be misunderstood because the capitalist economy is a money economy. So, an example in loaves of bread should be taken only as an approximation, because in reality, everything happens in nominal way, terms that we should discuss in a quite the same. Now, if we have this situation, the surplus per worker is 4 loaves of bread. He produces 12, he receives 8, he gets 4. Yes? Well, the maximum surplus is, and this paper, let us assume, 1200, which means 100 people can work and produce 1200 loaves of bread. Now the problem is, can they produce without any, as is assumed, the mainstream economics? We have capacities, people would like to get bread, and we ask, can this bakery produce by itself in a capitalist economy? The answer is no. Why? If we assume, for a while, that the owner of this bakery, one moment, does not consume, or even if consumes, okay, he consumes two, even let us say two loaves of bread, but how much? Bread, 10 loaves of bread. Doesn't matter. You see, at the end of the story, let us say he worked at full capacity, he has produced 1,200 loaves of bread. The workers have got 800 loaves of bread. 400 remains for me, for him. Yes? Well, let us say he is consuming again, 20. Well, he would not consume 400. Yes. How can he sell this bread to other people? Yes. It should be a market. Well, there are people with money, but I ask, where does the money come from to buy this 400? Well, the answer was that the demand for this surplus has to come from outside the consumer sector. You see, if you take the consumer sector seriously, you see that the law of sale cannot work, because the production in the consumer sector does not create demand which is large enough to absorb the whole production. So it must come from outside. By the way, in the history, we remember probably some of you from the Malthus with the leisure class which war the market. This is only works if the leisure class takes rents or taxes. Well, in modern terms, I say there must be something outside. By the way, my example with the consumer sector, with the bakery, is only an approximation. You can say, well, some produce bread, other produce, let us say, meat, and still other produce furniture and so on, and this is how it works. No, because in every firm, they separate, the same problem would arise, as long as we have production of consumers. So my bakery can be generalized to the consumer goods sector. And I can say consumer goods sector taking a loan does not create a market for the surplus. So how this surplus can be sold? He can be sold only by something coming from outside. There must be a sector which creates incomes and does not create consumers. This is the investment goods sector. This is the government sector. And this is the rest of the world. This outside sectors can create, we should, for most of the lecture, concentrate on the investments. It's very strange construction. Look, we have to have investment in this approach, not because we produce something useful. Also, it is very important that we produce something useful. But even if they don't produce something useful, they still create them. And this is why we understand what Kalecki sometimes said, that you create a third line, a second line of railway, if the first one is not utilized, or Keynes' idea of making holes in the world and making gaps in the holes in the
digging holes in the ground
and putting money and so on. So let us come back. The investment that sector is not important in this approach because what it produces, but because of creating external markets for the consumer good sector. Can I move?
Yes. No problem.
Now, how many workers must be employed in the investment good sector to ensure full employment? Well, in my example, it's very easy to calculate. It must be 50, assuming the same labor wage in both sectors. 8 loaves, 50 workers, times 8 is 400, and 400 is exactly the surplus of the consumer goods sector, yes, at full capacity. If 50 workers work in the investment goods sector, the bakery can be fully utilized. And if the number of employed people is less than 50, than 50%, in that case, the consumer goods sector cannot be fully utilized. And what happens now is we ask if the employment and the investment sector is less than 50, then we have unemployment. And this is the basic problem of what the capitalist economy is. Shortage of goods in the centralized economy, shortage of labor in the capitalist economy. Now, to move from this, let us say, very simple example, but I think an example must be so simple that it, there is no misunderstanding what you want to communicate. Now I present you a traditional sector, two sectors with nominal, well, it should be nominal, but still, I still will illustrate now I will introduce directly without numbers anymore. So we have two sectors, each sector is integrated, which means there is no intermediate products. R is, V is the wage bill, and R is our profits, E investments, C consumption, and the lowercase letters denote the sector, and you have, let us say, the whole economy. Of course, you can make it with the relative time, very complicated, but still it is enough in this very, very, very primitive form. Now, you see, well, in my presentation, which I prepared later on this with colors, that the E and RC are the most important point. VE is the wage bill in the first sector, and RC is the surplus in the consumer sector. These two must be equal in order that the production finds a market. Why? Because RC is the surplus which cannot be stored. This is 400 at full capacity, whatever it is. And V is the demand coming from outside. This I assume here is so-called extreme classical saving function, which practically means that workers do not save, and capitalists do not consume. This is, of course, a very extreme assumption, but still, the model works with it as well. So the first equation, and the only one, I have two, I have only one more. Yes. Is this one, VE is equal to RC. And very important, very, very important is the arrow, which shows which variable is determining, which is determined. The determining is the wage bill and the consumer in the investment side. And the variable which has to adjust is RC, the surplus of the hood. How many, what can be sold in the, on the consumer demand depends on how much, how big is the demand coming from outside according to formula one. Now we can, let us say, develop this formula, will not, this remains with you, everybody can copy this my presentation. So a very simple wage bill is, let us say, that is presented as a product of wage rate. Here for the first time we have the wage rate V, small V. L is the employment and the subscript are the same. So this on the and then the have the different X is the product of the or the factor of the consumer goods sector minus weight rate, which means in the brackets you have the surplus per weight and multiplied by LC gives you the total surplus. Now by manipulation, very simple, and taking the first difference, we get the formula 2. Now this formula is interesting. It says that the increase in the consumer goods sector delta LC is equal this expression on the right side, with what we have delta LE, the increase in the employment or investment goods sector. And the very interesting is, in the brackets, you have here in the brackets V over VX minus V. This is the relation of the wage rate to the surplus per work. Well, I will give an example and then we shall find that not complicated at all. Let us assume that the wage is 12 euro, let us say, but euro is at the same time the price of a loaf of bread, so whether we use euro or bread is the same. Wage rate is 8 and or 6. And we find out using this example that the relation in brackets, yes, is 2 or 1. What does it mean? This is the 2 or 1 is the investment multiplier in terms of persons, not in terms of values, because normally when we speak about investment multiplier, we take delta y over delta y, delta I over delta I, yes. But here this is as a relation between people working at different sub, which means the two and one. Let us move. I assume, let us say, I ask, what happens if we have
sorry to interrupt you, but perhaps
continue to.
No. If we could go back, I think that could not be quite clear. What we have at the bottom of the slide is what is an analysis. What happens when the wage rate is reduced from 8 to 6?
We shall discuss to 6, you know. Yes. This example is exactly.
Yes.
Yes. Let me continue. No.
Yes.
Let us assume that investment sector increases by 10 persons. Delta L E or I is 10. And the multiplier is 2. The multiplier 2 means that the wage, the rate is 8, as in the first example. Now, if the multiplier is 2, we get delta L set 20. Now it works, look. 20 additional workers produce 20 units per, sorry, 20 times 12, which means 240 loaves of bread, yes, or euros if you take what keep at bread, yes. Namely, 160 for themselves and 80 for the others. Okay? Now, let us assume that the multiplier is 1. And multiplier is 1, we learn from the first part that the wage rate decreased from 8 to 6. What happens? The multiplier is 1. Now, at the same employment in the investment sector 10, and the multiplier of 1, we get delta is 10. 10 additional workers produce 10 times 12, 120 loaves of bread, 60 for themselves, and 60 for the others. This is the main point of the lecture. If you decrease the wage rate, you reduce unemployment. You reduce unemployment in the consumer goods sector, even if you keep the same level of employment in the investments. This is, of course, a completely different conclusion from that which mainstream economics tells us. With workers are like something which you can sell on the market, like potatoes or like something like this. The lower the price, the more people would buy potatoes. And the higher the price, the less they buy. So if there's unemployment, well, labor is too expensive. It should be reduced. And it is being reduced in the last quarter century, all over the world. And the unemployment is higher than it was previously, much higher. And the rate of growth is lower. Well, this is the point. At the end, I repeated, the lower the wage rate, the higher unemployment, given investment. This is our position. And mainstream, the lower the wage rate, the lower unemployment. Well, this is where the when the story starts. Now let us move to some facts. So here you have the presentation of the labor share. So on the labor share over the last half century, you have a lot of countries. For the share of wages.
Maybe we should go really to your question.
This is the wage. Here. First, there were some increase in the share of wages because of full employment, but workers had a lot of possibilities of requiring wages. Sometimes, especially in countries where social partnership, which I will discuss later on, does not exist, and England is a country of this kind, and majority of Arab countries as well, disregarding Germany, Austria, and so on. So there was a little bit. And then what really happened in the 70s was the oil, the changes in the price of oil, dramatic changes in the price of oil, stagnation, and really at that moment the share of wages increased because there was a fight who is going to lose between workers and between business. Well, but if you begin now from this peak, this is the period which I'm interested most, from 80 to 2010, we have everywhere a declining share of wages, and this includes Poland as well, but we should move to Poland a bit in a while. Now, we have made continued one. No, this, I move to point four. Productivity-oriented wage policy versus labor market flexibility. Okay. You see, before I start, it's a very important graph, a very important presentation, because it shows you that a very strong correlation between unit level costs on the one side and the prices. Prices are here represented, if I remember well, by the GDP inflator. Yes. Yes, GDP. Real GDP.
But real GDP.
It is inflation here by the GDP deflator, the general price index. Of course, you can have different. The result does not depend. Of course, we see it is not, let us say, very exactly point by point, but the relation is very clear, which means if unit labor cost changes, you have changes in the it is not exactly because there are some factors which are not inside it. This is first of all raw materials which are not produced or commodities, yes. And there are some changes that in the distribution of income, very slow, but it takes place. But the correlation is very, very strong. Now, you see, this fact explains the movement of wages, not the quantity. You never were, nobody was able to show a close relation between prices and quantity of money. So what they did, they changed M1, M2, M3, M4, well, whatever showed better results, but no results are good. By the way, if you take the last 10 years, we have a dramatic increase the quantity of money. We'll discuss what quantity we take, but anyway, all the quantities, outside the real one, including when you have a deflation. So if you had to have a proof that the two terms are not related, we have some. So there is a strong correlation between unit labor costs and prices. And this means that if we reduce labor, unit labor costs increase more slowly, prices increase more slowly too. And by the way, we have not only inflation of a low degree, we have more and more deflation, including Poland, because unit labor costs does not Now, what is productivity-oriented wage policy? Productivity-oriented wage policy is a policy which says whatever is the distribution of income between labor and work, between labor and businesses, or labor and capital, let us take it as given. But from this moment on, we share the progress in productivity. So if productivity increases, labor wages increase and profits increase, pari passu, step by step, which means that all take part in the progress, in the progress. Why this is so important? You know, some say this is just socially desirable, and well, it's true, but it is important economically. Why? Now, because people who earn are the most important buyers. If they don't get enough, they cannot buy it. So somebody said yes, that people produce cars, but people buy cars. So if they don't earn enough, they are not able to buy as much as they bought previously. Internal demand. And let us say, first of all, demand inside the countries depends very much on the size of the internal market. And one of the main factors is increase in wages more or less pari passu with labor productivity. Change unit labor costs, and if we reduce the rate of growth of wages, of prices, because of unit labor costs, this influences negative the internal demand. But there is one factor which works in the opposite direction. This is external. Because if your prices increase, if prices increase more slowly in this country than in outside, than in the rest of the world, the possibilities of exports are easier and the imports become more difficult. This is a very important point, because this is the basis of protectionist policy and the policy of beggar your neighbor policy, which means you, the workers of this country, become less, but because prices do not increase as much as outside, it can be sold outside. And by the way, if somebody has problems understanding what happens really in reality, let's have a look at Germany. A classical example I will produce. Now, this is a little bit more complicated than I say here, because the exchange rate policy is a topic which I would need a little bit. May I ask about this? Yeah. Yes. ideas. This I want to explain. How does it work? Well, before I stop, we should come back to this point. Look, the labor market flexibility works if you want to outcompete the others. But if the others do the same, you are in the same position where you were previously. So as you know, you run and the other stay, so you are first. But if all run, you are in the same position as you were previously, but all are poorer. So this is the danger better your neighbor policy. And this is not an accident that when Kalecki wrote about three ways to full employment, he spoke about private investment, he spoke about budget deficit spending, he discussed the redistribution of income, but nowhere about export surplus. Why? Because it is not a method. It can be used only for one country, for two countries. And the other I pay. So if you take it together, it produces nothing. By the way, this race for a better position, now, as I already showed, and why, in, let's say, the reality, all try to be cheaper. But when all are cheaper at the same degree, nothing happens. How should we organize? I deal with this point because, indeed, this is one of the points which is important for Poland and for everyone, is labor-oriented policy, productivity-oriented policy, which means that you share the advantages of technical progress for the society as a whole. And you can have here, I have an example on let us come back. Sorry. I assume here one person that we have two countries, the country A, which technical labor productivity would increase next year by 1%, and a country B, where the labor productivity would increase by 3%. Well, this is not very, you cannot know very exactly, but you know how it was, and you can assume. Now, how should it look like the policy where the rate of growth is now in A countries? We have 2%, not 1%. Yes, 1%. And then I said we have a central bank which sets an inflation. This inflation target is 2%. Now, if the expected rate of labor productivity growth is 1% and the target inflation is 2%, wages should increase by 3%. This should be discussed and decided by workers, by business, under the supervision of the government. And if this is the case, at the end, the target inflation would be achieved, would be 2%, and the workers would get exactly as much as the labor, as the productivity grows. Indeed, they should require 1 + 2 = 3% growth of nominal wages. And with wages 3% higher, labor units costs would increase by 2% because labor product wages increase by 3 and productivity by 1, so unit labor cost would increase by 2. Prices would increase by 2. And if the price increase by 2, then the workers will get 3 - 2, 1%, exactly as they would. And if labor productivity increases by 2%, then nominal wages should increase by 4%, 2%, no, 3, by 5%. 3% labor productivity, 2% inflation target, together 5%. Yes? If wages increase by 5% and productivity increases by 3%, then the unit labor cost increase by 2%. And if labor, if unit labor cost by 2%, then prices increase by 2% too, as the inflation target requires. Well, and wages increase by 5%. Prices increase by 2%, wages increase by 3%. It's exactly the rate of growth of labor. Of course, this are simple example. Life is much, much more complicated. We could discuss different groups of workers, different groups of, well, a lot of difficult problems. What I said here is macroeconomics, yes. It is something which would have, let us say, what is called social market, social market, which people discuss. Central of central trade unions, not unions of let us say, railway, but all central trade unions representing whole class of workers and representation of business the same, not one group. Now, please continue for. We have a group. This is please. Fine. Yes, also, this we have, as I have shown already, we discussed the share of labor from the audience. Yes. Yes, we have already this. Now, we know that as a result, this sequence was not the same as I wanted to have it, but still I would have to repeat. The declining share of wages produced, first of all, the declining share of wages, which we have shown, but it produced something else. Of course, there is no unique. Complications. The reason are much more complicated, but look at this growth of GDP per capita in 12 countries, yes, since 61. By the way, this graph has been made by Lamont of Canada. I am using it, and I want to stress the statement of the presentation. You see how the rate of growth from above 5% is slowly, slowly, over thousands of years. Exactly half a century. And we are at the level of 1% for this 12 countries. And this is not simply here. In the United States, the situation is better, but all over the world, we have the same situation. Could you please continue? Now I have, let us say, some conclusion. How much time do we have?
Another 5 minutes.
5 minutes?
No, okay. We need some time for discussion.
Okay. As you see, member countries of the European Monetary Union have set a target of inflation of about 2% per annum. How has this target been achieved or not, and what have been the consequences? I will make it a little bit shorter. Let us take yes. This is the situation in the last 10, 11 years in the European Union. You have the target is red inflation target, 2% over 10 years, more or less, it should be 20%. Now, what happens indeed? France was the one big country which was, let us say, following the target. And now has Now, southern countries, well, a little bit, as you see, how it should be in a Mediterranean country, yes, a little bit more irresponsible and had a higher increase of labor and its cost. But let us see, by the way, not so much as Germany was below, because you see, if you are in a monetary union, you should be, you should act according to the rules. Spain here, this southern Europe, Greece, Portugal, Spain, and Italy is the only country a little bit bigger. All others are not very important. Italy is. But Germany, you know, over 10 years, union labor costs have increased by nothing. I almost said my name up. Not even by 10%, which means something like 1% per year. And indeed, prices increased over this time in the United and Germany by 1% per year. While the German inflation was 2% in France. Now, over 20 years, 1%, you see, it makes a difference. Would like to. This is France, you see. Productivity increased by about 18% over 10 years. Nominal wages, let us say, something like 40%, 140 indexes. And this result was, as you see, this labor, unit labor cost and prices increases pari passu with the tax. Now, let us say Germany. You have the same, not high, the same increase in labor productivity. But what you have indeed, you have nominal wages per hour which move. Nominal wages, not real wages, nominal wages move with labor productivity. Which means the unit labor cost do not increase or increase very, very slow. Now, this produced a major problem inside the monetary union, namely extremely high export surplus, which now are about 7% of GDP, 7% of GDP in the biggest country in the union, and corresponding, not all because some go outside, inside the union. By the way, why it is so dangerous, this development? Because outside you can defend yourself to some degree at least by exchange rate. And this was indeed what happened in the past period. In the 80s and 90s, we had this problem. So the Germans, well, Americans were different because of unification, but before and at the end of 92 years, that countries which suffered from surplus, the German surplus, devaluated, depreciated their currency. And the Germans restarted it. And then they depreciated it. And you see this very here in Italy, but to some degree even in England and in France. Now, inside here, you do not have this possibility anymore, because the euro is heavier. So indeed, without the monetary union, Germany could never make this policy of this intense, because this policy was practiced more or less at the time, but not with this intensity. And what would be the result? The result would be either the German would change their policy, which I doubt, or the monetary union would stop to exist, because you cannot, by the way, whether this is a policy which makes sense from the point of view of Germany, I'm not sure whether I have this quotation. Okay. There is somewhere in Spanish that I won't give you, know, not exactly, it's the numbers. The surplus, Erfurt surplus, is about 200 million, I use the same.
Billions,
but I mean billions. €200 billion per year. And the losses of internal demand are estimated at 400. Which means that not only outside countries suffer, Germany suffers too. Also, the situation is better than the others, but they suffer. Their investment are the lowest, and almost in the especially public investment. The rate of growth is very, very low. Lower than in France, and of course, lower than in the Union. So this policy does not make sense, but there is no possibility to convince Germans that this is a wrong policy, because the thesis is we make a good policy, if workers do not are ready to work, so this must be okay. Yes. If this would not be changed, I think the future is quite bleak. I think it is bleak. Now, a few words. 1 minute?
1 minute.
1 minute.
1 minute is 1 minute.
1 minute is 1 minute. You see, all this applies to Poland with one difference, that Poland is inside the countries which, to some degree, have advantages because on the side of receiving goods, which means the GDP which is used is higher than GDP produced because of the import surplus. On the other way, this import surplus kill part of jobs. Yes. And you have people here. Now, one advantage is that Poland has her own currency. And therefore, it should not join the club as long as its competitive position is so weak. By the way, previously in Poland too, the idea was, well, we have to get into the club. When we are inside the club, everything is okay because we have a good currency. But the reality has proved that inside the club, it doesn't matter whether your country name is, let us say, Greece or even Spain or Germany. So, which means that inside the Union, you still are known. And if your situation is weak, so as long as it is possible to have enough currency, it does not give very much, but it gives something which you don't have when you have inside the country.
Thank you very much. And now we come to questions and comments. And as usual, please introduce yourselves. And since we are a little bit short of time, we would all appreciate it if the comments and questions were direct and rather short. Please, the floor is yours.
The question is over there. I should say welcome, Janek, again. It wasn't so long ago that President Toporowski sat here as our guest lecturer. Now he is with us in the audience. Welcome,
Janek. Yeah, thank you very much. I want to thank Professor Waski for, as usual, a very incisive and insightful lecture that I wish I had given. I want to make just three points, and I'll make them as briefly as possible. First of all, I cannot resist saying with the two most distinguished Kaletskians sitting in front of us about the wage share that in the 1930s, Kaletsky was also studied this, and actually came to different conclusions. And the different conclusions were based on the fact that in the 1930s, it was considered that if you looked at the wage share, you should look at the manual workers' wage share, because that was, in effect, the cost of production in industry. You were excluding the wages of supervisory workers and the middle classes. And that manual wage share was relatively stable. So I mention this, I don't want to start a discussion amongst Kaletskians as to what this means, but I think I would like to note it. My second point is about the productivity-determined wage rates. To a very great extent, labour productivity, as Professor Kaletsky showed, Professor Wasky showed at the beginning, depends on how much investment takes place, because as he showed, the productivity of workers in the consumer goods sector depends on the demand in the investment goods sector, and more generally on the fiscal deficit and on the trade surplus. So there are connections within this. It's not a purely technical matter. And then finally, I would want to question the issue of currency depreciation as a solution to to competitiveness. I believe for most countries in Europe, the smaller countries, and in particular for the small countries like Greece or Austria, depends very much on the degree of trade specialization. Because if you depreciate your currency and you have trade specialization, your domestic costs rise by the amount of the increase in the cost of imports. And if you have trade specialization, you cannot diversify. So what then happens is that the effect of this is that it lowers real wages. So if Greece, for example, which has 40% of its GNP is imported, if Greece went out of the euro and depreciated, they would be faced with a rise in import costs. And the question would be, do they hold wages or do they allow wages to rise? If they allow wages to rise to maintain the same level of real wages, then you get a wage price spiral which easily moves into hyperinflation, and I believe would if they went out. In other words, the problem, even with the possibility of devaluation, comes back to the real issue of the real issue, which is that if you that competitiveness in the export trade is obtained usually at the cost of a shrinking demand in the economy, as I think Kaletsky said in the 1930s, and therefore it's not really a solution.
Can we collect some questions and
Tomasz Janis. Professor, I would like to ask, how do you assess the possible effects of the productivity-oriented wage policy in the light of changes in structure of GDP, mainly the move from labor-intensive sectors to capital-intensive sectors? Because the declining wage share might be explained by this gap between the productivity and real wages, but also by the changes in the structure of GDP.
In which direction?
The declining declining share of labor-intensive sectors, some financialization of economy.
Do you understand correctly that this maybe this, but what is the question? You believe that this is the result of the change of the structure?
No. I think that this productivity-oriented policy might not be as effective in this situation, or less effective.
Why?
Because of replacement of labor with
changes in the structure of employment may result in mitigating the effects or strengthening the effect, depending which way it goes. This would be my understanding of the question. Another question, and then we okay. There is a question, and then we ask Professor.
Good evening. Good evening. I want to ask you this problem which you put between France and Germany, as well as France. France is better with what you show with productivity and so on. But by the fact is that Germany has won to a certain extent this battle because they have a much lower unemployment rate at the moment. France is nearly to break down. It's quite, they have an unemployment of youth, of young people, I think from about 40%, 30-40%. So I have the feeling, how to convince the German government? Because on the top, if you are on the top and you look at the whole, it is right what you said. Because it is logic, it's not very difficult. But if you are in a position of the strong, that you can make even out of quantity, then you can reproduce your employment. So what can one do? Because as election in Germany shows, the Germans are quite satisfied with the situation they have. Also, if you say that they have some problems in productivity, because they invest much more in Mercedes-Benz, VW, they are investing in China, in Russia, and so on. So they take their money and they make their investment other else. So how do you see what possibilities do we have to get out of the situation?
Okay. Thank you. We now give the floor to Professor.
I am not sure that Einstein was the last question.
No, you have.
Einstein was the last question. I am not sure that we can convince the others at all. If you follow, for instance, the stream in Germany, the efforts every day of every day, everywhere, in the radio, in the TV, in the paper, it doesn't produce any effect at all. Well, the only thing which can convince the Germans is that they get into troubles, and they are getting into troubles, you see, with deflation, with limited possibilities of selling abroad. Well, they have some happily constellation of words that they could, let us say, they would already have problems because they diminished the export surplus inside the EU, and this would be a great problem for them. But in the same time, they were able to sell a lot, let's say, of cars and services in China and so on. This was, you cannot base very much on this. And the problem is how the situation would develop in Germany. I think that one possibility is that if the rate of growth would fall and employment increase, they would change their policy. But I'm not sure. Perhaps they would come to the conclusion that wages are still too high. You see, all the time I find in the publications sentences like this: our labor costs, I mean in German, are the highest in Europe. This is, by the way, true. let's say, don't take into account hyperactive. If you take, let's say, simply how they work per hour, yes? This is not, you cannot compare countries by, let us say, scientists, he gets, let us say, per hour 10 euros or 20 euros, and the other gets 50. That's the problem. The unit there, of course, is how much he gets and how much he produces. Now, if you take unit there, of course, the situation is completely different. But it is very difficult to convince them. But that's the problem. I'm not so sure. I'm not so sure. And, well, I don't exclude that, that the solution would come from outside in the sense that, which is, let us say, a motive that is very much, very often used by his classmates, that sooner or later Madame Le Pen would come to power, would take over the government, and I don't say how it's called in Italy, first of all, the great country. On the other hand, we see that Brussels, which is, let us say, very strong when dealing with Poland and with Greece, has sometimes different when it deals with France. Happily enough, you have noticed a few days ago that the fiscal pact, which was, let us say, very important, and one day from the other, it was not so important. Yes, and France and Italy and Belgium, I suppose, yes, have more time to change this situation. Well, you see, the real danger which I see as a big alternative is that the monetary union and the EU is very ill, let us say, but not enough to die, and treated not enough to heal. It will be in between. When the situation would be very bad, Mr. Draghi would come and we'd defend the euro, and it worked for 2 years, yes? Now, at the next occasion, they will buy under some excuse bonds, which is prohibited, but they will do it, yes? In danger, in periculo moris, yes, how it's called in German. But once it is over, they will revert. So this is the danger which is not enough to do in work. The second point about the structure, you see, if you move from the labor-oriented policy to wages, to firms, to sectors, it is far very complex. Because the rate of growth of different sectors is not the same. The rate of growth of labor productivity. Now, this rule which I create requires that wages increase pari passu with general labor. And this creates a lot of problems for sectors which increase stronger, and sectors, first of all, which increase slower because their problems will increase. I will not go into the problems, a separate topic, very complicated, not solid. And as far as the first, I would thank you very much, Janek, for this remark, because indeed, the shared situation of money workers is much worse than we see, much worse. Because what we now call workers consists always on popular, comprises of two managers with very high incomes. And if you look at the relation between, by the way, you have seen, you know, United States, that the average increase, but the median did not increase at all, which means a dramatic change of money. And by the way, we have data for the United States, but no, before the war, there was a separated fiscal workers, non-fiscal workers. This distinction does not exist anymore. And in the statistic, to find money where it is important, I don't know whether it is possible or who. Perhaps, yes, perhaps not. But anyway, what you said is very important, that the share of manual workers increased much more than the share of wages. Because in wages we have now the incredible high wages of managerial and bankers and so on, which pay out.
Okay, thank you. Taking into account time, we can possibly take another one or two questions. Yes. Okay, two.
Hi, I'm Javier Arnaud. Well, there is evidence, empirical evidence that, for instance, in the BRIC countries, Brazil, India, China, South Africa, the wage share, the labor share, is also declining as the developed world. However, the growth rates are still very high in the last 10 to 20 years. So, is this, can we foresee, can we expect lack of sustainability in the case of these countries?
You are sure, I don't know. You are sure that since the share of wages in Africa and in China is very low?
Yes, it's declining, yes.
It's possible. Marianne perhaps can help me. I don't believe that this is. You see, if we take countries with so low level of wages, whatever is the share of wages, the wages are
so low.
A fraction of our wages. So whatever is their share, even if their share would be very high, they are still very low. I do not know this topic in order to give you really an answer, but if Janek would like to say a word, I would be happy, but perhaps we take other questions.
Tim Kappen, British Labour Party. I wonder if you could just give us some comments about the UK situation, because the UK currently has the highest rate of growth in the European Union, as I understand it, but productivity hasn't increased. The service sector, low wage sector, has increased. What is your take on that? And secondly, you have said that future growth will depend on productivity linked growth. But if in fact we are seeing, which is the growth of the low wage sector, for example, in the UK, what has got to happen is not productivity related growth, but rather an increase of the wage share of GDP. Because that's where the problem is going to be. Because, as I say, in the UK, the problem comes because we've had no productivity and the low wage sector has increased, yet we've had growth. More slowly, I'm told. Okay. Well, in the UK, I would like some comments.
Oh,
well,
my hearing is better.
The comment I have that in the UK, it has the highest rate of growth in the European Union at the present time. However,
after they dropped this policy of austerity,
yeah. But they have currently they have a high rate.
And they have their own currency.
Yes. But when we look at productivity has not increased significantly in the UK over the recent period. And also we have seen that the low wage sector, the service sector, has increased. This appears to run contradictory to the point you were making. And the second point I was making is that because of the declining wage share, you have said that we have got to have wages linked to productivity. isn't the real solution is for wages to take a higher proportion of GDP, not just focused on productivity.
This is one step farther than I say. I say for the time being, let us keep at least the share. Let us keep at least the share, and you will say if it is still better. By the way, if you can show us the share of wages, I would be then. Because United Kingdom is separately. Back. Yes.
Okay, come back.
That's okay. Yes. You see, United Kingdom, you look, this is the only country, by the way, you have an answer. The only country where the decline of the share of wages was the lowest, if at all. You see, if you take the period between 95, yes, and 2010, you have an increase of the wages. Okay. So, by the way, this is what, let us say, without knowing it, you said it, but you see, this is works exactly in that sense which we discussed. You see, and if you take it into the end of the story, you look, England is now United Kingdom, of course, is about 64, and it was in 1960-65. No other country can show such a record.
You just made me a happy man.
But if I may offer a comment, because this refers both to your question and to the question that the other gentleman asked before. I think for clarity, when we want to show the impact of changes in money wages on the rate of growth of GDP and employment. Mm-hmm. For simplicity, it does make sense to assume a given constant composition of GDP and employment. And of course, when we observe changes in sectoral employment, especially from high-paid sectors, where also productivity rate of growth is high, like industry, towards lower-paid and with a lower changes, lower increase in the rate of growth of labor productivity, like in services, then of course this will be a factor that mitigates or decreases the total effect. Decreases the total effect of reduction of wages or increase of wages, the main line of Kaletsky's and Blaski's argument. Okay? So of course you need to take both into account. And I think
I don't understand. You say that if the share of...
If the share of industry...
With low...
With wages. High wages... And high growth of productivity decreases. Because it ships off. It shipped off from the United States to China. Shipped off from Britain to where it
should. The share would decrease.
The share would... And at the same time, the share of services increases where rate of growth of productivity is low. And also on the average, wages are lower than on average. Those are the trade and others.
Yeah, but what would be the result?
And the result, when, because of those structural changes, the result will mitigate, will reduce the effect that you would have if you assume
I'm not sure whether it would reduce or intensify.
Wait a sec.
I am not so sure. I think that it would intensify because you have, let us say, two factors. One which I discussed, and this is a better thing. Now you say very rightly that changes, structural changes, and by the way, this was the question here, just plays a role. And indeed, it may be that you are right that.
I didn't produce one additional assumption.
If you move from wages in the structure changes toward the sectors with, let us say, lower wages, and the sectors with, let us say, higher labor intensities, like, let us say, services and so on, probably this would increase. So what we say here, the statistics here, is partly due to reduced wages and partly due to changes in it will be a sector which, let us say, explains, and maybe that you are right that this is one of the reasons, of course. So observation. You see, if you wait with so large aggregates, of course, some changes may be very, very important. May you
also how much room there is for reducing wages
the sense
and services.
Of compensate, but the sense of, let us say, being part of the process. Yes, at once. But it is a part of the process, because if you take, for instance, Germany in the last period, the dramatic increase in the share of wages. Surely, that's the increase of export surplus in industry is the best paid part of the economy, so in an opposite phenomenon. Well, it is an important topic you mentioned, but it should be discussed. In general, probably you are right that it is one, probably it was one of the factors which influenced the result. What we see is not only, let us say, push against the wages, but at the same time some structural changes which work in this direction.
Okay, I'm afraid we are coming to the end of our tonight's meeting. And as a rule, my role is to, to draw, every tale should have a morale at the end of it. So I'll try to conclude by emphasizing this very critical difference between the approach of the theory of effective demand, especially as elaborated by Kalecki and developed by Lasky, other Kaleckians. And this is that reduction of wages is not an instrument to increase output and employment. To the contrary. And this is, of course, in a sharp contrast to what we learn from the mainstream economics and economic politicians that are guided by it. I would also like to note that notwithstanding the pessimism that Professor Lasky shared with us regarding the economic policies in Germany, I think, to some extent, the Germans nowadays follow the Americans, who often, every now and then, say, do what we say, don't do what we do. And it is characteristic that although the Bundesbank and the German economic policymakers say you must not increase wages, wages in Germany, in the past 12 months or so, have been increased.
their GDP and also the expected rate of growth, you can see that it's still very low, but expectations are that there will be recovery in Germany, possibly linked precisely to this very moderate, but nonetheless, change in business determined wages and increasing, as I said, very moderate, but some increase in wage rates. This is what we see in the statistics. And finally, the question is, can we then draw a conclusion that perhaps the solution is to increase wages? And I think this is a clear position that you would see in a section of Kalecki's 1939 study, which was then reproduced in English in essays in Economic Fluctuations on Money and Real Wages, where Kalecki argues that yes, in an open economy, and this refers marginally to comment made by Professor Toporowski, i.e. that the net effect depends on income elasticities of imports and exports of countries like Greece or Poland or other, is the rise in prices of imported goods large enough to dominate the effect of improved competitiveness of your export sectors or to the contrary? But what is the argument there in Money and Real Wages? And I, as I understand the argument of Professor Lasky, is that in an open economy, if you were to go for higher wages, you would lose your competitive position when all around, when all make efforts to reduce money wages. So in a sense, in a globalized economy, there is far less room for improving your position by rising unit labor costs through increasing wages higher than labor productivity. The point is, can we maintain relative shares constant? And what we observe is to the contrary. And this immediately links to a very important issue that is widely discussed about secular stagnation in market economies. That was reintroduced by a famous paper by Larry Summers, some I think 2.5-3 years ago, and then much discussed. And it's argued that we now live in a, or we started living in a period where our destination is secular stagnation, that we must learn to live with 0 or 1% growth. This is not because of fate or some external forces. This is because of the policies which we run. And Lasky's argument tonight shows that this is precisely because when shares, relative shares of your domestic demand that is generated from household demand, from wages, declines. Because the share of labor is declining, then whether you want to compensate it with increased consumption by taking credits,
or by expanding through export surpluses, both ways are not viable. They are not stable, long-run solutions to the problem. The problem is how to keep income distribution more or less constant. And I think this is a challenge. I think we all should thank Professor Lasky for his excellent presentation and applaud him for that. Thank you.
Tak jest. Jeszcze raz powtórzę, 18 grudnia, zatem w czwartek, zapraszamy Państwa na spotkanie z profesorem Leonem Podkaminerem. Od razu jeszcze powiem, że w dniu 20, to znaczy w sobotę, naszym gościem będzie Sławoj Żiżek, który odpowie na pytanie Wasyl Ojerowa.